etiology of tremors. Coming to what is the definition of the tremor? Tremor is involuntary, rhythmic, and oscillatory movement of the body part. And I'm briefly telling about the types of tremors. One is the rest and action. In the action, we have a kinetic tremors, we have postural tremors and isometric tremors. In the kinetic, you have a simple kinetic tremor where the tremor is throughout the voluntary movement. Whereas intentional tremor, when you reach the target, the tremor is increased. Whereas the task-specific kinetic tremors, like writing, you have a tremor whenever you're doing the task. And postural, you have a position-dependent and position-independent. And you have isometric tremor, whenever the muscle is contracted, you have a tremor. Briefly, where you find these tremors. Rest tremors you can find in the Parkinson's disease and advanced initial tremors. Action tremors, you can have a different types, like postural tremors, is found in physiological tremors, and enhanced physiological tremor, essential tremor, tardive tremor, midbrain tremors, also called a Holmes tremor, and cerebellar hypotonic tremor, and neuropathic tremor. These are all the action tremors. And kinetic tremors you can find in cerebellar disorders and midbrain lesions, and task-specific, like handwriting, orthostatic, and other task-specific tremors. Isometric, what is it before? Muscular contraction during sustained exertion. So classification briefly is, again, the rest and action, the same postural, kinetic, isometric, task-specific. Main today we focus on pathophysiology of the tremors. So here there are four basic principles for the tremor genesis. First, we have to know what is called oscillators. So oscillator does not mean one single anatomical structure, but consists of body parts and functional connections. And in these four, these are the four which are required for the tremor genesis. One is mechanical oscillation, reflex oscillation, central oscillation, feedback. And this will contribute in the peripheral generation and central generation of the tremors. This is the loop showing the central oscillators, spinal cord and muscle, from muscle to the oscillatory movement. And we have a mechanical reflex, as we got normal reflex, and there are central loops which will modulate. So this
reflex are same or different?
No, this is almost the same as our normal reflex. And these are central oscillators. I'll come in central oscillators. We can more find in the what are the structures in the brain and spinal cord and muscle, and finally you have a tremor. Coming to mechanical tremor of the extremity. So when you consider a stretched out hand, tensions or muscles tonically activated to counterbalance gravity, some of the muscle fibers will be activated at the resonance frequency of the hand. The hand will oscillate at the resonance frequency, which is determined by the equation of root of k by inertia, where k is determined mainly by the stiffness of the muscle and inertia of the oscillating limb. Whereas the moment, this inertia is a moment of inertia of point mass is about an axis perpendicular distance of r from the axis. So it is mr square. So mostly the frequency depends upon the stiffness and also the mass or weight. So the resonance frequency is decreased by adding mass or increased by adding stiffness. So this will be helpful, because by adding mass, we can decrease the frequency of the tremors which are generated peripherally. So for practical reasons, it is easier to add inertia by attaching weight of 1 kg to the dorsum of the head. So I think we are not doing, previously used to do in our EP lab, by attaching 1 kg weight. Peripheral origin, which origin of tremors, will decrease the frequency when you add a weight. Whereas central origin of tremors, there is no difference in the frequency. Peripheral origin example is a physiological tremor. Whereas central origin tremor example is essential tremor.
How do you increase the stiffness then? Just make the ask the patient to make it tight.
Yes, sir.
You can tighter
and make the exam tight and see. Automatically will increase.
Frequency will increase or amplitude will increase?
Frequency will decrease.
Just can you show the frequency again? So the frequency depends on K stands for
stiffness. So when weight is increased, frequency decrease.
So and
when stiffness is increased, frequency will be increased.
Inertia will be a function of the mass.
Yes, almost the weight. So when weight is increased, the frequency will be decreased. When the stiffness is increased, frequency is increased. And reflexes. When the reflex gains, the conduction time for the efferent and connection of an operate, then oscillation will result, like a normal reflex mechanism. And we have central oscillations. There are two hypotheses. First is the rhythmic activity of the group of neurons within a nucleus. Example is the vulvar nucleus and thalamic nucleus. And possible second mechanism that oscillations that are generated in the loops consisting of neural populations or different nuclei and their axonal collections, basal ganglia and cerebellum, that the axon connection, wherever the pathway is oscillatory, then that also will cause the tremor. Feed forward loop is a malfunction within the CNA, especially the cerebellum. Actually, it is a critical system for the strength and duration of the first agonist, timing and shape of the antagonist agonist. So whenever you do action, first you have agonist action, then antagonist will interrupt the movement, and second agonist will help in reaching the object. So when there is interference, you can't break the movement and there'll be an overshoot. Because of overshoot, finally you will have the antagonist also will be delayed. So you'll have a hypermetria. Because of this one, you'll get a tremor. So this is the frequency of the tremors what you usually find. So the physiological and enhanced physiological tremor is more frequency, 10 to 15, whereas cerebellar or Holmes tremors, palatal tremors are of low frequency, whereas initial tremors and PD will be the 4 to 12, but practically the less frequency, less 3 to 6 is the PD, more than 5 to 12 is the essential tremor. So physiological tremor is originated from the unique motor unit firing properties and mechanical and reflex resonance in the sensory motor loop. Physiological tremor is considered peripheral in origin, and weight loading will decrease the tremor frequency by altering the biological physical property of the reflex loop. This is the essential tremor mechanism. So you have a cerebellar neurodegeneration, there is a Parkinsonian cell loss, and you have a decreased GABA. So there is increased cerebellar neurons with pacemaker activity, and it will trigger the thalamocortical rhythmic activity, which leads to tremor. So finally, it is the cerebellar and thalamocortical pathway which causes tremor. So essential tremor is considered central in origin. So weight loading will not decrease the frequency of central generated tremor, what I said before, but will rather dampen the amplitude because the central driver for tremor remains unchanged. Both types of the tumor are at the similar frequency, so the weight loading will help to distinguish from one from the other. So this is the graph showing the blue one is the central tremor, this is the peripheral tremor. This is the frequency, and this is the amplitude. You can see on weight loading, the frequency is reduced, and there is octonic acid which will decrease the amplitude. It is similar to that of a GABA. So they are telling the mechanism might be the both in the peripheral and central tumor, because of octonic is reducing the amplitude, but there is a close relation.
Like alcohol.
So it will act on GABA, so it is decreasing the amplitude of both peripheral and central. So they're telling some close relation, but the weight loading will help us to differentiate between the central and peripheral tremors. So we can differentiate between the physiological tremor and the initial tremor when they have a similar frequency. So this is the video showing essential tremor. Here I could not forward, this is missing, so. This is the essential tremor. The patient is not having rest tremors, and when he stretched his hands, he has a tremors. So the video is not working. So the patient is not having wrist tremors. Whenever the hand is stretched, you are having a tremors in the hands. You can see no tremors in the resting, and whenever the hand is stretched, we have tremors. The video is paused. Okay, I'll go on. This is on EMG showing a patient with the initial tremors. You can see here at rest. And we are testing at right APV and right adductor. You can see the flat lines in surface EMG. And whenever he was posturing, you are having the EMG burst, and it will be frequency around 4. So this is the right flexor, this is the right extensor. And coming to pathophysiology of Parkinson tremors, the central oscillators are thought to be the main generator and driver for the Parkinson tremors. Peripheral mechanisms are unlikely to generate tremors. They have a little role in the modulating the tremor. The current what is accepted model is the dimmer switch model. So you have the dopamine, this retrobulbar area. There is a dopamine depletion here, and there is a dopamine depletion in the pallidum, and which will activate the motor cortex. The pathological activity is passed on to the motor cortex, and with the loop of motor cortex, VL is the similar to the VIM nucleus of thalamus and cerebellum. So this is the pallidum is the switch, whereas this is the producer, this cortico, thalamus and cerebellum. This is the producer of the tremor and also the amplitude of the tremor. So is the switch and dimmer model. Dimmer which explains the why cerebellothalamic tract is activated in patients with rest tremor and why deep brain stimulation of VIM nucleus improves tremor. Currently most accepted theory regarding the genesis and modulation of the Parkinson classical resting tremor. So actually, normally this tritonical degeneration occurs in Parkinson's disease, which is...
So what is the retrobulbar area?
Yeah, this is the different area from the... This is the different area, not the stritonical area, which is normally involved in Parkinson's disease. Is this is the area they found they have dopamine depletion, in turn cause a dopamine depletion in the pallidum, and they will have a pathological activity there. This is the trigger. Then it will be passed on to the corticothalamic cerebellum tract, which will cause the tremor. The pallidum is
for Parkinson's.
Yeah, this is only the resting tremor mechanism for the Parkinson's.
So what happens then? Dopamine deficiency, how does it cause tremor?
There are the pathological oscillations in the pallidum. Other rhythmic oscillations. They'll project to the pallidum, and they'll have a pathological oscillations in the pallidum, like rhythmic oscillations. And this activity is passed on to the CTC, corticothalamic cerebellar. But it is only the transient, so that's why it is called a switch. And the production and also the amplitude is maintained by the corticothalamic cerebellar. So that's why when you do the DBS of VIM nucleus, you have a tremor will be decreased.
No,
why the CTC is involved, that's why. But I think they mentioned the pallidum, or you can do the DBS of STN, can decrease the tremor, because STN has a connections with the cortex bilaterally. So when you keep the DBS of either STN, subthalamic nucleus, or pallidum, you can have a decrease of tremor. This by VIM nucleus, you're decreasing tremor based on this mechanism. That's what they're telling. So finally, the CTC loop is main involved in the tremor.
And the thalamus, cerebellum, and motor cortex is the regular thalamus cortex loop.
Yes.
The only new thing about this is then the retrobulbar area projects to the pallidum, because that circuit is affected. This circuit gets
yes
normal.
So normally there is no oscillation. It's an abnormal oscillation.
Yeah, no abnormal oscillations.
Like in the cerebellar. There are normally also there are oscillations.
Yes.
But this is abnormal.
This is abnormal. And they found that olivary nucleus and the thalamic nucleus, initially hypothesis was that only, the thalamus pacemaker hypothesis and thalamus filter hypothesis. they are invalidated. The in vivo, they find that they are not involved in the Parkinson's disease.
Really, this specific picture is of the Dimbus switch hypothesis.
Yeah.
You have to describe that. You have completely ignored that.
No, he said
it. Yeah, he said
what, so it. It makes the different hypothesis.
Yeah. So first, the depletion in the retrorubral area, their depletion, this will project to the pallidum, and these are pathological activities will project it to the CTC pathway. So it is a switch model, and this is a production model.
So is it known that the pathological whatever oscillations are there, the frequency of oscillation is known?
Yes, sir. Frequency of oscillations of pallidum is similar to that of this one.
Rest tremor.
So actually, a lot of hypotheses are going on. Previously, they thought of that oscillatory mechanism also there. So they found they have the low GP has a low frequency. So another time they found that pallidum has high frequency. The thalamus will be modulating the frequency. So these all models are wrong. Currently, the current model they are accepting is this Dimbus switch model.
Is the role of acetylcholine?
Acetylcholine they didn't mention.
Usually, yeah. They say, why are we giving
acetylcholine? What is the role of acetylcholine? Here, they mentioned only the another model is some serotonergic also can.
Acetylcholine is an interneuron which connects GPI and.
That is also another hypothesis, like RAFI is connected to the pallidum, serotonergic, because. Why the anti-dopamine drugs are not working in the tremor PD? They're telling it may be serotonergic pathways. So nothing is like confirmatory. All are like hypotheses. Another way explaining the cessation of resting tremor during voluntary movements, the striatopetal circuit may not project their pathological activities to trigger the cerebrothalamic circuit during voluntary movements. So normally basal ganglia will control the precision of motor movements by facilitating movements of the required muscles. The facilitation activity in the precise motor cortical area and inhibit the surrounding cortical areas of non-required motor program. So this explains the what is related to tremor that is inhibited. So you don't get the tremor while during voluntary activities.
This from where is the variable table?
This is
the marker table.
Yes, sir. 2011 mark. 2011 paper was there. And we have different types of tremors in Parkinson's. One is you have a classical resting tremor, where the resting and the postural tremor. This postural kinetic tremor is the re-emergent tremor. So they'll have the similar frequency. And the second type is you have a resting 4 to 6 and postural kinetic 4 to 9 Hz. And third one, you don't have a resting tremor, but you have a postural and kinetic tremor. These are the different types you can find in the PD. So this is the resting tremor you can find. And you can see the re-emergent tremor when he outstretched the hands. Video is not playing. This is the rest tremor you can see. And actually, it is increased while arithmetic, like concentration. When I ask to say from 100 minus 7, the amplitude will be increasing in the Parkinson's disease, where it will not happen in the initial tremor. So, this also. One thing you can differentiate between the ET and Parkinson's disease. Another thing is re-emergent tremor. So in essential tremor, when you outstretch the hands, immediately you get a tremor. But there is a latency of 1 to 10 seconds in the Parkinson's disease. So this will be helpful to differentiate between both the Parkinson's and ET, because sometimes the frequency will be the same thing. And on most of the some Parkinson's will have both postural tremors, rest tremors, and advanced ET also can have a rest tremors. And you can do in the survey CMG lab also. Whatever we can mentally arithmetic, we can do it, and you can see the latency also when you are doing surface EMG. So this is This is both a TRACE tremor. You have the frequency of 4 Hz in the Parkinson's disease, a TRACE. And you have neuropathic tremors. So mostly you find in disc gamma glowing polyneuropathies and hereditary neuropathies, you have this neuropathic tremors. These are postural and kinetic tremors. Frequency will be the 3 to 6 Hz. So the mechanism they postulated is the distorted and mistimed peripheral sensory inputs reach a central nervous system processor, thus the intact but misled to produce by the central nervous system, they misled and produce a tremor. Psychogenic tremor, the pathophysiology is unclear. There are two types. One is a coherent type and a co-contraction type. In coherent type, you have a conscious and subconscious rhythmic movement of the affected joint. The tremor frequency is usually 6 Hz. And coherent, in the coherent type, they cannot rhythmically move the same or contralateral extremity at different frequency, except at subharmonics. The performance of rhythmic movement at various frequencies either suppress the psychogenic tremor or causes frequency to shift to that voluntary movement. That means when the patient is having tremor, if you ask the other limb to do the tremor on other limb, the frequency will change. So that will tell about this is a psychogenic tremor. And another is co-contraction tremor. It occurs in the conscious subconscious coactivation of the muscles. The amplitude of the coactivation tremor is proportional to the degree of the coactivation sign, and tremor stops during when you are interrupting the coactivation. You can see the bedside test coactivation sign. You can see example, you can palpate the agonist and antagonist muscle on strength testing. It may be easier to feel the contraction of the antagonist muscle when the agonist muscle is tested. So example is when the triceps is activated, the bicep muscle is being tested. So both will be the contracted. So these are criteria for psychogenic tremor, like abrupt onset, static course, spontaneous remission, and difficulty in classifying, the selective disability, and changing the amplitude and frequency, unresponsiveness, and increase of tremor with attention, and lessening of tremor with the distractibility, and responsiveness to placebo, and absence of other neurological signs. So this is one psychogenic tremor. So when you ask to tell the numbers backward, the tremor will decrease. You are asked to tell the numbers after the frequency is decreased. Almost the frequency is reduced after concentration. And coming to Holmes tumor, it is a combination of basal ganglia and cerebellar tumor. It has both western and interstitial tremor, and sometimes there is a postural tremor. The frequency is low, mostly it will be the 4.5 Hz. And there is a delay between the lesion onset and first occurrence of the tremor. This is the Holmes tumor. You can have both rest tremor and also the action tremor. So this is the rest tremor, what he is having. And when he outstretched the hand, he is also having the tremor in the hand. Videos or not. So this is another Holmes tremor. So you are having a tremor at the rest. And at outstretched also she is having tremor. And another is the cerebellar intention tremor. The critical nucleus appears to be the globus emboliform nucleus. the lesion in the cerebellum or in the brachium conjunctive pathway from the deep cerebral nuclei to the contralateral ventrolateral thalamus. Lesions in the brain stem or brachium conjunctive or cerebellum are always associated with neurological signs. And mostly what I said before, the cerebellar feedback, feed forward control is needed for deceleration of the limb as it approaches the intended destination. Otherwise, post-pointing or overshoot occurs, followed by the terminal oscillation. This oscillation typically decreases as the limb approaches its target, increases as it approaches the target, like intentional tremor. The mechanism of the crescendo terminal increase of tremor is uncertain, but resonance in the ventrolateral thalamic cortical loop contributes, because VM and neighboring cerebral thalamic are effective, the stereotactic targets for intentional tremor. This is the, she is having essential tremor. She is having a cerebellar tremors. Yes, video is missing. Yes, sir. Actually, previous video is missing. And this is the dystonic tremors. And you can see the sensory tric series is decreased. Coming to other static tremor, there is a subjective feeling of unsteadiness in the stance, but only in the severe cases during gait. So generally they'll complain, they'll have a tremors while standing, but while walking the tremor is reduced. And where the EMG, surface EMG, will have a 13 to 18 Hz pattern. And most of the lesions, they think it may be the bilateral brainstem and the spinal motor nuclei are involved. So this is the frequency what we get in the gastrocnemius muscle. We can have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, almost 12 or 13 Hz. This is the orthostatic tremor we recorded. And another important point is there is a coherence. So what are the muscles which are distantly located from the muscles? We have the similar frequency. You can see the gastrocnemius and the sternocleidomastoid, sternocleidomastoid and paravertebral. All the muscles have the similar frequency. This is a unique pattern. This is found only in the orthostatic tremors.
Now, what is that?
Coherence. Sir, all these muscles, which are even the far, means actually we are testing from the gastrocnemius. Even if you're testing the muscles in the...
Even if you check sternocleidomastoid, you'll get the same.
Same frequency. Whatever muscle you tested, similar frequency throughout the body. But remaining essential tremors or whatever different tremors, you don't have a similar
frequency. Why is it not like an essential tremor then? Is the tremor also addressed, there's nothing. When you raise the hand up, they have a tremor. And when it, so this is also similar. When they're sitting, they have no tremor. When they stand up, there is tremor. When they sit down, there is no tremor.
Frequency. And other thing, whatever muscles you tested, they'll have a similar frequency.
Yeah, That's what I know. Even hand repeat tests, they have a resistance.
Yeah, I had one survey CMG.
It's much more faster, that's why you were saying.
Much more faster. And I had a patient who is having orthostatic tremors and a family history of essential tremor. And a survey CMG is having both frequency in the hands and also lower limb of 18 frequency. So this is because of coherence spectrum.
So lower limb tremor was what in that patient?
Like what? Gastrocnemius.
Like what rate?
18 Hz.
18?
18. And in upper limbs, when we tested in the upper limb and in the hand stretcher position also 18.
18?
18. And they have family history of ET, means essential tremor. We don't know exactly, but they also have tremors. Similar to this frequency we had in upper limbs. So this is the palatal tremor. So whenever the lesion in the glenoid triangle, you have the tremor in the palate. So coming to use of surface EMG, it is able to distinguish PD, Parkinson's disease, from essential tremor and enhance physiological tremor by varying the tremor frequency and muscle contraction pattern. You have a co-contraction pattern in essential tremor. You have alternating muscle contraction in the Parkinson's disease. You can also differentiate Parkinson's and ET by latency and concentration, what I said before. There'll be no latency period in essential tremor, and you have latency from 1 to 10 seconds in Parkinson's disease. and can differentiate between the physiological tremor and essential tremor by the weight load effect. It is a non-invasive and sensitive, and repeat examination techniques believed tremor analysis of EMG should have a wider application aspects and research prospects in the clinical practice. Thank you.
Actually, Mark Allen has an interesting paper which I just read now. It's on actually the how the different models came. Huh?
Yes, sir. First is thalamus pacemaker hypothesis came.
Yeah, so generally, see, we were in the brain there are oscillators.
Mm.
And the main way neuronal function happens is by oscillation. Different neurons constantly talk.